Take your Bibles with me to John's Gospel, John chapter 4. We're going to get back into our series this morning, chapter 4. Very familiar chapter in the Bible for any of us who have been around Christian circles for a while. You've probably heard dozens of sermons from this text, and this is, of course, Jesus' encounter with the woman at the well, a Samaritan woman. Many say, of course, that John 3 and John 4 are parallel, they're similar, and likewise they are. We're going to look at his encounter with this woman, and it's going to be eye-opening, and it's going to be encouraging to us this morning. So if you're there in your Bible this morning, say amen. We'll start reading in verse number 1. The Bible says, "Therefore, when the Lord knew that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus made and baptized more disciples than John, though Jesus himself did not baptize, but his disciples, he left Judea and departed again to Galilee." And let me explain this. This is would have been one sentence in the original language. And what is being told here is, of course, Jesus' popularity was growing. And of course, the Pharisees were taking note of that in Judea, in that region close to Jerusalem. And no doubt they would have had it out for Jesus. They would have wanted to have arrested him and had him, of course, killed. So Jesus understood everything, of course, being God. And he understood that since the scene was getting hot, that he needed to leave. And he would do that from time to time. He would excuse himself from some of these situations because he was on a very distinct and planned out schedule. And he knew his ministry, he knew it led up, of course, to Calvary. And the timing of that was precise, and the timing of that had already been foretold. So this is what it's saying here. Jesus and his disciples were gaining, of course, momentum, but Jesus knew he had to leave Judea and go back to his hometown region of Galilee. And the Bible says in verse number 4, "But he needed to go through Samaria. So he came to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied from his journey, sat thus by the well. It was about the sixth hour. A woman of Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said unto her, 'Give me a drink.' For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. Then the woman of Samaria said to him, 'How is it that you, being a Jew, ask a drink from me, a Samaritan woman? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans.' Jesus answered and said to her, 'If you knew the gift of God and who it is who says to you, "Give me a drink," you would have asked him and he would have given you living water.' The woman said to him, 'Sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. When then do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, and as well as his sons and his livestock?' Jesus answered and said to her, 'Whoever drinks of this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst. But the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life.'" Jesus' ministry could be summed up and summarized within one verse, Luke 19:10. "For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which is lost." For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. Jesus had a singular focus when he was on earth, and it was that to fulfill the mission that he had been given from the Father, and that was to seek and to save the lost. Likewise, in John chapter 3 here, as we come to chapter 4, we see Jesus involved in an encounter. Now, there's very similar things that take place in this encounter, but there are some differences between those who are involved in the discussion with Jesus. And as I studied this week, I was aware of these. In Nicodemus' case, he sought out Jesus. In this case, with the woman at the well, Jesus initiated this encounter. Nicodemus was respected as a Pharisee, a teacher among teachers in Israel. The Samaritan woman was despised and an outcast. Nicodemus was a very moral person. He would have lived a high standard of life. And the Samaritan woman was an immoral person. We'll see in just a few moments. She lived a life of despair. Nicodemus was a Jew. He was a full-blown Jew, and the Samaritan woman had come from the line of interracial Jews, those who had mixed with the nations surrounding them. Nicodemus was seeking, he was looking for answers, but the Samaritan woman was indifferent. She didn't know that she would meet Jesus at the well that day. Nicodemus was highly trained in religion and in the scriptures, but the Samaritan woman was ignorant to basic things of their belief system. But the things that they had in contrast did not change what they had in common. Each one needed to be born again. And this morning, I just want to say, if you're here this morning and you think that you've gone too far away from God, if you think you've messed up too much and there's no way that God wants to have a relationship with you, well, I want to tell you this morning, you couldn't be further from the truth. Jesus loves you. I don't care what you've done. I don't care how far you've gone away. I don't care how many times before today you've rejected him. He loves you and he's seeking you out. If you've come this morning looking for answers, if you're coming this morning, something just drew you in. I'm telling you, it was Jesus. His Holy Spirit got you up this morning and said, come to church so you can hear a message like this, so you can understand Jesus and what he is to you and how much he loves you. So we come to this account, and Jesus, of course, is making this long journey from the region of Judea on his way to Galilee. And the Bible says that he comes to a city in the town, a city in the region of Samaria by the name of Sychar. And he gets there, and there is found Jacob's well, the well that had been dug many hundreds of years prior, given to Joseph from Jacob. And this would have been a well that for many, many years had brought life to those who would go to the well. And Jesus makes it to the well. Of course, we learn in scripture that the well is very deep. And if you study this out, the well that we're speaking of here today is still in existence. It was one of the deepest wells of its day and even till this very day. And so this well would have had a spring of water coming, a source of water that would have continually come forth. And so Jesus makes it to this well, and he is wearied in his journey, the Bible says. He's tired. Could you imagine God in the flesh, tired, thirsty from a long walk? You see, Jesus would have spent most of his ministry going from city to city on foot. It's hard for me to get my kids to walk half a mile, you know, and myself included too, but Jesus' life would have been going from city to city on foot. So he's tired. It would have been hot. It would have been dry and dusty. He would have been thirsty, and he gets to the well and gets there about the sixth hour, the Bible says. And as he gets there, the woman is arriving as well. She had come to draw water for herself, no doubt. And this is unusual in a lot of ways because, number one, women never go anywhere alone. Think about that. How many guys, when your wife is hanging out with her friends, they all go to the bathroom together, right? Maybe it's just me noticing that. They all go, you know, and they congregate, and they, you know, very seldom do you see a woman alone. But anyhow, I thought that was the truth, but maybe you guys don't agree. So here she is alone, and this was because she was an outcast. She was not accepted among the other women of Samaria. So she comes at the sixth hour, and she comes to draw water, and there Jesus is there waiting. He's waiting, and then he asks her the question. He makes a request to her. He says, give me a drink. Give me a drink. And Jesus encounters this woman. Now, I want you to understand, this is radical. This is breaking all protocol. This was something that a rabbi would have never done. Number one, publicly speak to a woman. Number two, speak to a Samaritan woman at that. You see, the Jews had no dealings with the Samaritans. They looked down upon the Samaritans. They were, I would say, prejudiced towards the Samaritans. You see, a Samaritan was someone who their family had chosen to intermarry with the nations around Israel, and so they were of mixed culture. And because of this compromise in the eyes of the Jews, they had gone astray. They had become unclean. They were no longer allowed to come to Jerusalem and observe, of course, the Passover and other types of rituals there at the temple. So these Samaritans decided that they would make their own place of worship. They were willing to erect their own type of temple there on Mount Gerizim. And so not only were they outcast from the Jews, but they were not viewed as religiously right. You see, there was racial division and religious division. Does that sound familiar today? The church today, even though they believed in the same God, they were divided. And today our churches are divided for similar reasons. A lot of it is cultural. A lot of it is preferential. Some of it is racial, and some of it is because of religious things that are non-essential. And I'm telling you, the devil is just laughing at the church in America because we're so divided, and we're being conquered by this world, and it should never be the case. You know what I've enjoyed over these last several years of being at Westside? I've enjoyed the diversity here. I've enjoyed that there are people from all different walks of life and different cultures and different, likes and dislikes. And it's been great to just be a part of a body that there's not a lot of this pretense here. So Jesus is, yeah, that's something to clap about. So there was a cultural separation between Jesus and this Samaritan woman. And this woman acknowledges this. When Jesus asked her to drink, she says, why are you asking me? The Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans, and let alone a rabbi with a woman. And so Jesus replies to her. He said, hey, if you knew who it is who asks of you for drink, you would have asked me, and I would have given you living water. Living water. So Jesus flips the script. He forgets about his natural thirst, and he puts aside his need for a moment, and he addresses her bigger need, the need for living water, the need for a relationship, a true, genuine relationship with him. And he uses this as a way to spark her curiosity. You see, he would have already gotten her attention by talking to her, being different, being distinct than all the other Jews. And then he puts out this term to her, living water. Living water. And I want you to see the master at work. He was a master at getting to the heart of the matter. He was skillful in getting people to think about spiritual things. And so Jesus poses this question. He says it to her, and she looks at him, and she's still not quite getting it. And she says, how are you going to draw? Where's this living water coming from? The well is deep. And Jacob gave this to Joseph, and he drank from it. And so did his children, his livestock. Are you greater than him? Of course, the answer to that would have been, yeah, I'm greater than him. But she's still not quite on the same page as Jesus. But Jesus is patient. He continues to engage this woman. And he says to her, whoever drinks of this water will thirst again, but whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst. But the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up unto everlasting life. Now, I hope you guys understand by now, Jesus isn't talking about water. He's talking about salvation. He's talking about future, the Holy Spirit within us, and how because we would come to him in faith and receive him, that we would have a wellspring of life that will flow from us, and it will ultimately lead to us spending eternity with him. And what he's saying to this woman is, you don't necessarily understand it yet. You've come here for some water to quench your thirst temporarily, but I have something better. I have a water, a salvation that will satisfy you into millennia, into a billion years from now. You could be satisfied in me. I could give it to you. And let me tell you guys, what the world needs is to hear of that. Everlasting life, he said. So he engages her. He talks to this woman. He breaks all the rules. He's spending this time. He must needs go through Samaria. He shows his compassion. He's a compassionate Savior. He cared for this woman. He made the trip specifically to meet her there at the well. And I want you guys to understand something this morning. Our Lord Jesus, he's compassionate. He's not this person in heaven who's sitting here angry and wrathful looking at the world. He is still extending his graceful offer of salvation, and he has compassion on those who the world has turned their back on. God reminded me of this week that the way to break down a lot of people's barriers, the walls that people set up to protect themselves because they've been hurt, is through compassion. It's through showing them love, unconditional. This is what Jesus did as he interacted with her. You see, Christianity is different from all other religion. You see, religion, the world's way, is humans trying to work their way to God through their good works, through their good life, through their religious practices. But Christianity in the Bible is God coming to men and women through Jesus Christ. That's what Jesus did. He went to her. So he offers this living water, and the woman is intrigued. And she says to him, "Sir, give me this living water that I may not thirst nor come here to draw." So she still doesn't quite get it. She thinks Jesus is going to give her a water where she would not get physically thirsty anymore. She doesn't want to have to do the hard work of coming to the well again and again and again. But Jesus says to her, before he goes any further, engages her, he must make her aware of her need for a Savior, through revealing the fact that she is sinful. I want you to see it. Verse 16, Jesus says to her, "Go call your husband and come here." So of all things, Jesus says, "Go call your husband." Why? Because he's God. He knew everything about her. He knew that she was in a relationship she was not supposed to be in, that she had been married 5 times, and he reveals that to her. He says, "You have well said you have no husband, for you have had 5 husbands, and the one whom you now have is not your husband. In that you spoke truly." You see, Jesus lovingly and with compassion addresses her sin. We live in a culture where they're telling us today that we should not call sin, sin. We live in a culture where the church has moved away from using the word sin in messages and preaching repentance and the need to turn away from sin. We live in a world where we're being programmed to affirm sinful lifestyles and to say that it is a person's choice what gender they are. It's a person's choice who they love. Whatever is good for you is good for me. But that's not what we see in scriptures, my friend. That's not what Jesus is doing here. He's addressing this woman's sin. He's saying to her, "Hey, I know you. I know where you fall short. I know the sin that you have in your life. And in order for you to quite receive salvation, you must understand that you are lost before you can be saved." You know, the problem today is that many pulpits have begun to coddle people in their sin and say it's okay if you struggle with that. It's okay, and don't get me wrong, we all struggle with something, but we've got to understand that sin has a consequence. The Bible says, "For the wages of sin is death." What the Bible is talking about there is not just the physical death, it's talking about the second death, found in the book of Revelation. And those who do not come in faith to Christ, those who do not receive his salvation, his living water that he has offered to the world, when they die, they are left to pay the penalty for their sins on their own, separated from God for all of eternity in a Christless place called hell. Sin is serious, folks. Sin is nothing to play around with. Sin is nothing that we should look lightly upon in the life of those around us. You know, you have loved ones who you love dearly and you care about them and you want them to know Christ and you want them to make the decision to turn to him. Well, let me tell you, there has to be sometimes some difficult conversations that come up in order for them to realize their need for a Savior. But we have to do so with love. We have to let the Holy Spirit lead us in that. You see, Jesus knew he had to address this issue of sin to confront her because she was oblivious to the fact that she was in danger of being lost. Let me tell you guys, one of the purposes of the church is that we would be the pillar and ground of the truth in every generation so that people will know what sin is and what's right and what's wrong. And if we drop the ball, if we allow the truth not to be elevated, if we don't stand in opposition to the dumbing down of the truths of the Word of God, the doctrines of God's holiness, the doctrines of sin, death, and hell, if we allow that to fall, there will be casualties. So Jesus addresses her sin, and he lets her know, I know everything about you. And she assumes, I perceive, she says to him, you're a prophet. And then she gets religious with Jesus. She says, our fathers worship on this mountain, and you Jews say that only in Jerusalem is the place where one ought to worship. And so she starts to get religious with God. And that's what people have done from the very beginning. When they're exposed, they try to cover up their sin through religion. It happened in the garden when Adam and Eve sinned. What do? They fashioned fig leaves to cover themselves, to try to cover up their exposed sin. And it never worked. It didn't work then. It won't work now. And so Jesus says, woman, believe me, the hour cometh when you will neither in this mountain nor in Jerusalem worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We know what we worship for salvation is of the Jews. He says, woman, you're ignorant to the truth. And there's coming a day very soon where you will not worship at this mountain nor in Jerusalem. What Jesus was predicting, what he was prophesying to this woman was, hey, pretty soon I will give my life for the sin of the world. And no longer would there need to be sacrifices at the temple or at this mountain because I am the final sacrifice. I am the way of salvation. I am the way, the truth, and the life. He says in the statement there in verse 22 that salvation is of the Jews. He's not saying and emphasizing that every Jew would be saved. What he was saying to that woman at the well was, I am salvation. I am from the Jewish line. I am the fulfillment of the prophecies of the one who would come and set all the captives free. Salvation is of the Jews. But he says that, but now the hour is coming, and now is when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. You see, I told the early service, you know, there's plenty of places that call themselves houses of worship. There's one right down the road here, and they're probably singing songs too, but it isn't worship because they don't truly believe the Jesus of the Bible. Oh, I could take you down to a Muslim mosque this morning, and they're probably singing their chants. They pray more than you and I do, five times a day towards Mecca, and they probably have more religion than each and every one of us in this room. But are they truly worshipers? Absolutely not, because they have not come to the realization that Jesus is the only way of salvation. He's the only way to the Father. Jesus made it very clear. It's very narrow, the way to the Father. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by me. The only way to heaven that there ever will be is through a relationship with Jesus Christ. So what are you saying to the woman? Your religion can't save you. Your religious practices can't save you from your sin. See, the problem with religion is, when do you do enough? We can never do enough. We can never be good enough. The Bible says, for all of our righteousness is as filthy rags in the sight of a holy God. And there's nothing on our best day, in our best clothes, on our best behavior, we could never be good enough. This is what Jesus is pointing out. This is why he brings to her attention that he knows about her sin. And he goes on, he says, God is a spirit. And he's looking for those who worship him to worship him in spirit and in truth. And that's a significant statement, because God isn't limited to one room. This is what he was saying to this woman. God is not limited to your temple on the mountain or the one at Jerusalem. God is a spirit. He can be in all places at once. And he is what he is looking for. What he desires is that he'd be worshiped in spirit and in truth, my friends. You say, why is it that you guys meet every week to preach about this book and hold up these doctrines and teach this over and over and over again? Because it's truth. It's God's truth. Our theme at this church is times change, truth does not. You know, truth will set people free. You shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. And this is why we are here this morning to gather around the truth of the Word of God. And the truth is, salvation is not found in performance. You can never be good enough. I can never be good enough. But it's found in a person, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus Christ. That's not his last name. That's his title. He's Messiah. So this woman is exposed. She tried to use the religion card. That didn't work. Jesus quickly dispels that. And the woman, finally, she switches the subject. She knows where to turn. She says in verse 25, I know that the Messiah is coming. The Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. She had no idea she was talking to him. When he comes, he will tell us all things. So she says, we may not agree about where to worship. We may not agree about, you know, this or that. But let me tell you what we do believe, what you guys believe too, is that the Messiah is coming. Jesus says to her, I who speak to you, am he. I who speak to you am he. He says it to her very clearly, far more clearly than he did to Nicodemus. He makes it very clear. You see, Nicodemus had religion in his way. He had a lifetime spent of religious activity. And so he didn't, and the scripture does not indicate that he got saved that night when he met Jesus. He had to work through it, I believe. He had to come a little further along in his faith. But we'll see here in just a moment, this woman, she didn't have the religion to hide behind. She didn't have a righteous life to hide behind. She didn't have good works to hide behind. She was exposed before a holy God. And when she was presented with the truth of salvation through Jesus, the Messiah, she turned and she wholeheartedly received him that day. Let me tell you, if anyone is to be saved, they must come to Jesus as a little child. Put aside everything, your religious pedigree, your religious works, the fact that you're a good person. I've heard it over and over again. I just can't believe that God would send a good person to hell. The Bible says there is none good. No, not one. Yeah, they may sin differently, but we are all sinners. And this woman, she had egregious outward, very identifiable sin in her life. But Nicodemus had inward pride and arrogance and sin in his life as well. But sin ultimately leads to the same destination apart from Jesus. And this morning, I just want to encourage some in this room. You may have been coming to this church. You may have been baptized. You may have been, altar boys. I don't know. You may have been a part of Awana as a child. You may know all the scriptures. You may have all the awareness up here of Jesus, but it never got down here. You never bowed truly in your heart to Jesus and received him as your savior. Oh, my friends. Oh, I believe the number one tool of the enemy to send a lot of people to hell is religion. And if you don't have a true relationship with Jesus that bears witness through the Holy Spirit this morning, today is the day to come to him in faith. Oh, I'm convinced that we're going to be surprised who's in heaven and who's not. Many people that sit in churches week after week without a relationship with Jesus. But you can know. It's very simple. I think about, I was reading in Acts this week, the Philippian jailer. When he saw the power of God that shook the prison, and Paul and Silas were there still, and he says to them, what must I do to be saved? And they said this, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. It's that simple. Place your faith in only him, in him alone, and you're saved. This week, the last few weeks, I've been praying, like, God, give me an opportunity to lead somebody to Christ. You know, it's been a while since, one-on-one, I got to share the gospel with someone and see them do the greatest thing that they could ever do and receive Christ. And this week, God so graciously gave me an opportunity. I got a text from a friend a friend of their family's mother was in the hospital, and she was close to eternity, and they weren't sure she was saved. And so I get the text, and we're out with the kids at the park, and we're playing, and, sweaty, hot, but I get the text, and we're in Palmdale, and she was at Palmdale Regional. So I said, oh, we're going to head over there. So we head over there. I get to the hospital, get checked in, go up to the room, and she's there. She's by herself now. The nurse asked me to be as quick as I could be because she was in her last hours. They didn't expect her to make it through the night. Congestive heart failure, and she's in the room, and she's coughing, and, I don't know if any of you have ever been there with a loved one or maybe a ministry opportunity where someone's very close to eternity. It just gets real. It's different. It's a different vibe when you step into that. So I get into the room, and I get straight to the point. I said, hey, I've been in, your family asked me to come, and I just want to make sure that you're ready, that when you take your last breath here, that you would be with Jesus in heaven. And she said, I hope I will. I'm not sure. And I said, well, you can know. And so I shared with her a few scriptures. I shared with her how God loved her and he died on the cross for her sin. And that if she would just in faith call out to him, she would believe on him, she would get everlasting life right then. And she prayed and she received Christ. I'm telling you, the atmosphere in that room changed. She must have thanked me about 15 times before I could leave and held my hand tight and just looked me in the eye with just gratitude. I left, and of course I'm rejoicing. I'm just thanking the Lord for the opportunity. And the next day, I think a few days later, we're at church, and the gentleman in our church whose family friend it was, he came up to me and he said, hey, I just got to share something with you. The family, let me know that, hey, after their mother had received Christ, that there was a change in her physical condition. I kid you not. Listen to this. I'm just sharing this to give God glory. They said the next day they came and she was sitting up and she was laughing and she was talking. And the doctors said she improved so great, so much that her vital signs had returned to almost normal, and they were able to send her home to be with her family. And as I heard that, my heart just rejoiced within me. I mean, and it's like, it's nothing compares to that. And I'm telling you, Jesus is still in the saving business. He's still seeking. He's still looking for the lost. And he wants to use us. Jesus reveals to this woman, hey, I am the Messiah. I am he who you're waiting for. Just at that point, the disciples come back. And the disciples have gone into town. They've gotten some food. And they marveled, the Bible says. They had wonder in their hearts when they saw Jesus talking to this woman at the well. It was not the norm. And they were wondering, what is he seeking? What is he talking to her about? But none of them had the guts to say anything to Jesus. So the woman, she had heard the news of who Jesus was, and she had wholeheartedly received it, and she left her water pot. And it's a big deal when a woman leaves behind her Tupperware. She left her water pot there. And she went into the city. And she said to the men, she found the men in the city. Now, mind you, this is a woman who's an outcast. This is a woman who, of course, men in that culture still did not really talk or listen to women. But she went into the city. She understood she had a message that needed to be shared. And she found the men and she said, come, see a man who told me all things that I ever did. Could this be the Christ? And she, likewise to Jesus, she appealed to their curiosity. She used that question, could this be the Christ, to get their attention. And these men, they listened and they were curious. So the Bible says that they went out of the city and they came to him. The disciples, of course, were eating their in and out or whatever it was, and they were oblivious to what's going on, you know? They're oblivious to what Jesus is doing and what had just taken place. And so they say, "Master, eat, Rabbi, eat. Come on, here's the food, you know. We just traveled a long way. I know you're hungry, you're thirsty." And Jesus says to them, "I have food to eat, but you do not know." And the disciples are looking at themselves like, what are you talking about? Did somebody else bring them food while we were gone? And no, Jesus was using this as an illustration. And he says in verse 34, "My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work." He said to them, "My fulfillment, my satisfaction, my joy is to finish the will of my Father, to be about his work, the work of seeing souls saved." And let me tell you guys, a lot of Christians in this room, you're miserable. You have a nice house, you have a nice car, you have a good job, you have a decent marriage, your kids are doing okay, but you're miserable. And you know why? Because there's a bigger purpose for your life. The moment that this woman got saved, she realized there was a bigger purpose for her life. Therefore, she left her water pot there. She put aside her needs for a moment and went into town and found the men because she realized that what she had just received, others needed just as much. She put aside herself for a moment and looked to others. And let me tell you, the satisfaction that comes from other people coming into relationship with Jesus Christ, there is nothing that compares to it. And I'm going to tell you today, I had a lady, you know, come to me and say, I just can't find joy. I can't find it. I can't. And I'm saying to her, and in my heart, I'm thinking, here. Most believers in America today aren't about the kingdom first. They're not seeking first the kingdom. They don't prioritize getting the gospel out. And they don't live to fulfill the will of the Father. And so we try to fulfill ourselves elsewhere. We take sad substitutes to bring us temporary happiness, but we have no idea what true joy is. And I just want to tell you this morning, God sent me here this morning to tell someone in this room, you want to find joy? Start to follow the will of God. Start to bring the gospel to those around you. Start to prioritize what Jesus prioritized, and that's for others to hear the good news that the Messiah has come. Jesus, he modeled that. And he says to the disciples, he says, "Do not say there are still 4 months and then comes the harvest. Behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes." He says, look around, guys. Stop looking at just yourselves. Lift up your eyes, look on the fields. And this is a picture he's saying. He's not talking about literal fields. He's talking about the souls of men and women all around. "For they are already white for harvest." Jesus said to his disciples that people are ready. People are white unto heart. They're overripe. People are ready to be saved. He says, "And he who reaps receives wages and gathers fruit for eternal life." I heard it said this way: the first work of the whole church is to give the gospel to the whole world. John Wesley said this: "You have one business on earth, to save souls." I heard another missionary say this: "Either you are a missionary or you are an imposter." This morning, if we have no desire, if we have no fruit, if we have no burning in our heart to see others come to Christ, I would question my salvation. If for decades you've been comfortable to sit and sit and sit while people you know have gone into eternity without one iota of thinking to share the good news with them, whether it made you uncomfortable, whether it made them dislike you, whether it made them look at you sideways, who cares, who gives a rip? I'm telling you, hell is hot this morning and people are going there. And save Jesus Christ, if we would share him, there would be people who will get gloriously saved if we would just get about the harvest. How did Jesus go about this? He was purposefully different. He showed compassion to this woman by having a conversation with her, by saying, I'm even willing to drink from your pot, even though others would not even come within a 10-foot radius of you. I'm willing to drink water from your pot. I'm willing to be where you are. I'm willing to meet you right here at the well because I love you. And the problem is most Christians don't see past our nose. And so we don't love people like Jesus loves people. We don't show compassion. When was the last time you did something out of love for somebody? Just, I was thinking this week, you know, how God was radically working in my heart before we came here. And the whole philosophy of ministry that I had been taught, God revealed to me, it was flawed, and how I needed to reshape my thoughts and what it meant to serve people and to love people. And you know, God is just really putting it on our heart. You know, I'm thinking of a few things that I want to do to show the compassion and love of Jesus Christ, and have some friends who are helping me with that, and we're gonna get gas cards and we're gonna go out to neighborhoods and just knock on doors and say, hey, we wanna bless you. We know gas is astronomical right now. We wanna bless you. Here's a gas card. Hey, is there something we can pray for you about? Is there something that you need? Is there something that we can bless you with? And just be radical, be so different that those people are gonna ask, why are you doing this? What are you getting out of this? And I'm gonna be able to tell them nothing. I just love Jesus and Jesus loves you. And he told me to come to you and tell you that he wants to save you. He wants to give you eternal life. And all you have to do is believe on him. Sound like a good deal? I'm telling you, let's stop playing around, y'all. Either we believe it or we don't. Either we're going to live it or we won't. And we're going to see this nation, I'm telling you, the persecution that is coming, it's going to really divide the saints from the ain'ts. Are you going to still share the gospel when it could cost you something? Right now, we're not doing it, and we've had freedom to do so. Jesus looks at those disciples and says, hey, you don't even know the satisfaction that you're missing out on. You don't even know what fulfillment comes from for doing the will of God. And can't you see around you the people who would come? Don't be mistaken, guys. People will come. Bible talks about people came when that woman went into town and she had a bad reputation. In verse 39, the Bible says, and many of the Samaritans of that city believed in him because of the word of the woman who testified. You think she was happy? You think she had joy when she saw people coming to Jesus and she had a small part in that? You think she was fulfilled? You think that was something that the rest of her life she could remember and look to and find joy in that? And I think so. The Bible says that when the Samaritans, there were others that came to him and they urged him to stay with him. And he stayed 2 days. So Jesus held a revival in that town for 2 days preaching. Could you imagine? And the Bible says many more believed because of his own word. Many more believed. Then they said to the woman, now we believe, not because of what you said. There's some who are skeptical of her, rightfully so. For we ourselves have heard him and know that this is indeed the Christ, the Savior of the world. Y'all, he's the Savior of the world. He's the propitiation for not our sins only, but for the world. Who is it that God wants you to tell that this week to? How is it that God wants to use you to be part of that process of them coming to know him? I want to challenge us this week. Do something radical. Pay for someone's groceries. pay it back at Starbucks and leave an invitation to church. I mean, do something radical. Go to your neighbor and just bless them with a gift card. Do something radical. Show compassion. Show that you care, that you're thinking about them. It's going to blow them away. And then if they ask you, and then they're going to say, well, why are you doing this? They're going to be blown away. Then you're going to say, man, Jesus wants me to do this. I'm sorry I haven't done it sooner. But I want to, can I share with you something? Can I share with you how you can know that you have a relationship with Jesus? And the woman did it very simply. She shared with them what Jesus had done for her. Every one of us in this room could do that. You could share your testimony with somebody this week. And I just want to encourage you, that coworker who gets under your skin the most, invite them to lunch. Take them somewhere nice, not McDonald's, okay? Just, hey man, I just want to share something with you, man. I know you may have not known, but I'm a Christian. Let me tell you what Jesus has done for me. We're not responsible to save people, but we are responsible to be witnesses. I just want to encourage you. Jesus showed compassion. He went to her right where she was at, right in the midst of her sin. He met her. He loved her. He won her. Then she went into the city. If you've been won, if you've been found, you ought to find others. Found people find people. I'm going to say that again. Found people find people. That's what she did. And many came. Many came from the witness of one woman who was in an adulterous relationship who didn't have it all together, but she knew the main thing, that Jesus was the Savior of the world. And I think we all know that this morning. If you don't know Christ as your Savior, I want to encourage you today, come to Him. Don't withhold another day. Tomorrow isn't promised. Tomorrow isn't promised. And God wants you to know that you know that when you take your last breath this side of eternity, that you will be with Him in heaven. And you can know that this morning.